developments, one of the ones which we were particularly pleased about was the granting to us of the room in the homestead formerly used by the ALP. This had been subdivided into three smaller rooms, and we requested that they be allowed to be remain in that state, because we were able to put them into the characteristics of, firstly, an old-time bedroom, secondly, a library for our growing number of books. We've had a lot of donations, and we, at this point, I would like to say that if any of you have any books which are of historic nature or specifically deal with Altona, we would appreciate them to be put in there for our own use and for the use of coming generations. We have been particularly busy with working bees each month from a smaller devoted band of folk who've come along on the fourth Thursday, and they have done a great amount of work, and I personally, as president, wish to thank each and every one of them and urge them to continue the good work. We were also very fortunate in the purchase of three very, very nice glass cases, display cases, which became available through the closing down of a shop in the main Pier Street and the subsequent sale of the effects. We were particularly pleased also upon the fact that the Historical Society had a major part in the recent 150th photographic display put on by a combined combined committee of residents and the Society, although the Society, I must say, did the major part of it. But it was very, very successful. It was put on in the library annex, and was on for a week. Many interested people saw it, and at the end of it, a lot of disappointed folks said, is it possible to be put on again? So that when Mr. Barry Hansen was arranging the recent operation of recreation for Altona, he put the suggestion forward that we could put it on again for those who had missed it the first time. And although we, because of lack of space, we weren't able to put it on in its entirety, we put on possibly 50% of it, it aroused the greatest amount of interest, and was a complete success as far as we were concerned. Personally, I have to say that on behalf of myself and the family, we were more than pleased with the wonderful gesture of the Society in suggesting that one of the rooms there be named after my wife, Myrna. Now we've named that the first room in the Society there, the Myrna Walker Room, in recognition of the great amount of work that she's done in the last 20-odd years of her membership of the Society. Of loss, that was a very, very nice thing for me personally and the family to have shown that respect and thoughtfulness. They are some of the things we're doing at the present time. Other speakers will go back over the past and also what lies ahead for the future. But possibly that might be enough.
We're ready. Ladies and gentlemen, I think dinner is ready. Maybe we could ask Claude, isn't it, to suggest a way of
the
being
set. The main table will be the best.
All right.
To start off with.
It's the smorgasbord.
You move it to the very slowly.
Probably takes a beer.
over there. Larry was one of the first pupils at that school.
Me too.
And Tom. Who's the oldest out of there?
John. Larry.
Also, Altona House in Pier Street. If you look behind the modern shop fronts, that's where you see the original, the original structure underneath the sort of facelift on the front. And so a few plaques around the town would be pretty good and to show the people what was around. Also, a couple of things need preserving. I don't know whether many of you people know the historical Convict Road, which is Altona Road, which used to go past the Williamstown race course down near the Pines. If you have a look down there, there's all these bluestone pictures.
Yeah, it used to be all the way to Pier Street.
Well, there's not much of it left. And this is one thing we've got to preserve. If a new road happens to be planned to go through round by the Pines, I think it's up to the society to make sure that what's left of this road is not destroyed. We've got it forever.
Yeah.
Also, there's a couple of houses in the Explosives Reserve, which are very old houses. They're behind that tin fence there, and people just don't see them there. They're just locked away. And I think they're around about 90 years old. I think Councillor Grant had probably... No, he wouldn't remember.
I'd better leave them.
I think Councillor Grant lived in one of those houses for a while, didn't he? You'll probably tell us about it later on. So there, ladies and gentlemen, are just a few of the things which we plan to do in the future. We do hope to get the membership a little bit higher so we can go through all these things within the next couple of years. It's going to be a very big couple of years. I'm looking at a few people. They'd all love to come along. We're a happy family, so if we can build our membership up and keep the warmth of our meetings, we have a lot of fun. So I'll leave it with that. Thanks very much for the opportunity of speaking.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hansen, for those few words. I was told in no uncertain terms by my wife, don't get me on here. And I admit to thank you, Mr. President, for your short talk before, so I'll do it now or I'll get kick in the ankles when I get home. Now, it looks like Claude might be ready for the...
...a copy of Williamstown Historical Society's constitution to be altered and used to suit the Altona Historical Society. A letter was received from Mr. Wilson Evans, Williamstown historian, giving details of Altona's history. A pull team committee was formed with Councillor Cresser as the first president and Councillor Hearn as first secretary. Councillor Hearn is recognised as the founder of Altona Historical Society, the committee to consist of all of those present. The first general meeting was held on the 21st of July 1961 when the constitution was drawn up. For some reason which is unknown, no further official meetings were held until early in 1963. The first annual subscription was 10 shillings for adults and 5 shillings for students and juniors. Mr. Barry Prismo first suggested starting a historical collection, so he could well be the founder of our museum in 1963. In 1964, information was exchanged between the Society and the Mayor of Altona, Germany. At the end of 1964, membership had reached 24 members and one junior. Interesting to note, the Society's room had 3 keys in 1965. And it seemed rather unusual who had them, but however. These were held by the honorary secretary of the society, the shire president, and the fire brigade. The society's historical collection was first shown to the public on a regular basis on Sunday, the 3rd of October, 1965, with Mr. Barry Prismal on duty from 2:30 p.m. till 4:30 p.m. only one visitor came. Working days were first started on Sunday afternoons in 1966. The annual meeting could not be held in 1967 as not enough members present. The society reached rock bottom from October 1967 until July 1968 when no meetings were held. An appeal was sent to the council for help in obtaining new members. Mr. Alan Clark set a record when he became Honorary Secretary and Treasurer at his first meeting on the 20th of May, 1968. In 1969, the Society first tried to get the National Trust to classify a homestead. In 1969, first discussions were held about a history of Altona Dublin. Miss Lully was the first life member of the Society on the 18th of August, 1971. In 1972, Mr. Arthur Walker became the first official past president. The History of Altona booklet was published in 1973. It was similar to the Port Macquarie Historical Society booklet, cost to be 50 cents. The Back to Altona celebrations were held in October 1974. These were organized by the Society and were very successful. The April 1976 meeting was turned into a working day. That's rather an unusual one for us. In September 1979, membership had increased to 47, including one life member, Ms. Lully, and with 16 of these being non-resident members. Despite this, no meeting could be held on the 15th of October 1979 due to only 7 members attending. Quorum needed was 15 for a meeting to be held in those days. Museum was broken into and several valuable items stolen on the 18th of February 1981. The Society's 21st birthday was celebrated on the 21st of January 1981 in our meeting room. No founder members were present. The President, Mr. Walker, read the minutes of the founding meeting in 1961. Mr. Brands proposed the toast to the pioneers. Mrs. Hope Woosnam outlined her life with her family in Chicanoff in the Altona of 1919. The president proposed a toast to the Altona Historical Society remembering a foundation member, Mrs. Cox, who had passed away recently. Mrs. Woosnam cut the birthday cake, which had been made by the Honorary Secretary, Mrs. Myrna Walker. Early in 1982, our life member, Miss Lully, left Altona for Heidelberg, having first came here in 1929. At the annual meeting on the 15th of August, 1983, the quorum was changed from 15 to 5. The first end of year social evening held at the Library Annex on the 26th of November, 1984. The speaker was Professor Graham Davison, functioned a great success. And I might add that it was a great success for us because out of this we got our present Honorary Secretary, Mrs. Edith Simpkins. The homestead was finally recorded by the National Trust in June 1985, the plaque to be affixed in a later date. At the annual meeting on the 17th of August 1985, Mr. Alan Clark, Mr. Larry Fleming, Mr. Arthur Walker and Mrs. Myrna Walker were nominated as life members. A really successful old-time musical evening was held at the November 1985 meeting. A wealth of talent was discovered. At the February 1986 meeting, history was made when the new same room at the Park Entrance was named the Myrna Walker Room in memory of Mrs. M. Walker, who gave 21 years sterling service to the Society. After remaining unchanged for 21 years, the Society increased the annual subscription to $2 in 1985. Likewise, the entrance charge to the museum was increased to 50 cents for adults and 20 cents for children and pensioners at the March 1986 meeting. Before I finish these brief highlights and memories, I feel I must pay tribute to the many regular active members of the Society, past and present. Without whom this society could not survive a quarter of a century. They are many in number, however, I feel it is fair to mention some who spring to mind, namely Councillor Cresser, Councillor Hearn, Mr. Barry Prismal, Councillor Weaver, Mr. Sterling, Mr. Richard Ross Sr., Mrs. Jamie Smith, Mr. and Mrs. Alan Clark, Mr. Arthur Walker, and Mrs. Myrna Walker. Mr. A. Walker, our current president, is doing this for the third time. November 1985, the membership stood at 22 non-resident, 40 resident, and 6 councillors. We look forward to a very busy and interesting time in the next several years. Now, that is that, but just before I finish, I like to put my little plug in, and sometimes people might say, what's this got to do with Altona, what's it got to do with Altona Historical Society? But although I'm interested in the history of Altona, the history of Victoria, the history of Australia, I'm afraid I go further than that. I'm interested in world history, so I can't help putting this little plug in, that this is a very historic evening for us, but it's also a historic date in British history, because today is the 383rd anniversary of the death of Elizabeth I, Queen of England.
Thank you, Tom, especially for that interesting historical anecdote that you gave us then. It would appear that it's quite obvious that you've put a lot of work into preparing this history, and on behalf of the society and the guests, I'm sure I'd like to thank you for your work that you've done and for your speech tonight.
The little history booklet will of course come to the society after this meeting.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Brian. Well, I've got your attention. I think I might call upon Mr. Woodruff. Mr. Woodruff is the newly appointed Director of the Royal Historical Society of Victoria, and it's indeed an honour that you've come along this evening with your wife. We haven't had the big brass down here very often. I don't know if we've ever had. I'm sure it's possibly your first visit to the city of Altona. We bid you very welcome and await your words of wisdom with interest.
Thank you very much. I think I'm but a tinkling cymbal in big brass, nor am I a direct descendant of Queen Elizabeth. As director of the Royal, however, I'd like to bring you our fraternal, I think this would be used in different circumstances, but I think fraternal might be the right word, fraternal greetings on your 25th anniversary and the sesquicentennial of Altona. This is a word we're learning to pronounce in Victoria slowly. I still don't really know what it means. I prefer 150. It's easier to understand. But I said fraternal quite deliberately, and this was confirmed by what you said, this thought of the big brass. There's a slight tendency, I think, to look on the Royal as a father, if not a big brother. And I think we're really rather quite a little brother. And what we seek to do is to serve all the societies in Victoria, and increasingly we hope to do this. We've even actually bought all the microfiches of all the births and deaths and marriages at last, not before time, and even any day now we actually hope to have a projector to look at them on. That also not before time. But we really live in quite nice surroundings. Well, the surroundings aren't so hot. The old YMCA looks a bit sad from the outside, but if you actually penetrate inside, our offices are really quite pleasant. And our library is not a bad place to visit, and our meetings are quite fun to come to. We try, and increasingly will, I think, try, to speak for the history movement in Victoria to government and to remind government of their obligations to us, not to forget us, to give us money. We're having a little bit of a battle about the Public Records Office at the moment. We're trying to squeeze some money out of culture. I don't know if you knew, but the government's having a cultural policy any day now, and we're trying to take a large slice of that, trying to identify culture with heritage and us with heritage. When I say us, I mean the whole of the history movement and all the history societies in Victoria. We're trying to persuade youth sports and recreation that history is a recreation and is deserving of their goodwill. It's got their goodwill, it's just a question of getting their money. surprisingly enough, they're prepared to accept this. They're looking more and more at things that bring people together, people of different backgrounds, different parts of Victoria, bringing them all together in one unity. And in this, I think we're well ahead of the game. We're well ahead of most of the other organisations. But people have never looked upon us as a recreation. Tonight, I think, suggests perhaps we do have fun, and we are a recreation, even when we're being serious about history. And we're trying also to... Yes, we're trying to have recreation. We're having the state committee is meeting not too far away, wherever shortly, and I hope to come to that. And the state committee is a very important part of the history movement in Victoria. It's the way in which all the different societies can beat the royal over the head, not too fiercely, but it's a way of bringing to bear your feelings, what you want, on our council. Our council now contains representatives of all the societies around the country in a way it isn't. It's no longer a sort of frousty old Melbourne organisation. It's got a lot of people on it who actually know what goes on in the state, and they're responsive to what you say, but only if you say it. And the only place you can effectively say it is through your regional committees and to the state committee. And we're listening, we really are. In return, we'd like you all to come to our do for Heritage Week. It's not that far, as I discovered tonight. We're putting on a bit of a do at the AMP Square. If you've got some really super contributions, we'll hang them up too. This is an exhibition of all the sort of things we've collected over the years, and some really nice pieces going to be there, and some interesting pieces, and we have some of you at least will come along. Then also, we'd like you to join. You may not entirely realise this, but just for a few extra dollars a year, you can be a member of two societies for the price of only, almost only one. And the Royal does need the money. We haven't got all that many direct members, a lot of societies have members, but we need a few more direct members, people who come in and participate a little more actively and beat us a little more regularly over the head. I would now like to wish you well on this occasion and for your next 25 years and your next 150 years to Sydney.
Thank you, Mr. Woodruff, for your kind thoughts, and we appreciate the work that you are doing, and we wish you luck for the rest of your career with the Royal Historical Society of Victoria. I know a few of us went along to a meeting at the Royal Mint about 12 months, 18 months ago. It was very good. I can remember Barry Hanson was locking ladies up in the vault at one time. I think a lot of people think because you're a member of Historical Society that you're a fusty old lot of day-day birds, I think, but I can assure you we all seem to have a lot of fun. Thank you for your comments tonight. I think we might press on and call upon the Mayor to give his talk. The Mayor, His Worship the Mayor, Councillor Doug Grant, is in his second term, I believe, as Mayor of the City of Altona. Third term. He's been a councillor, I'd say, for about 20 years. Is that fairly close to the mark? 19. Oh, well, that's a pretty good guess. And he's served the City of Altona with distinction in that period, and he comes from a long time family of residents of the City of Altona. Gives me great pleasure to introduce to you Councillor Doug Grant. His subject tonight is Altona as he knew it and knows it. Is that correct?
Yes, that's okay. Right. Thank you, Ian. Mr. President, Mr. Woodruff, and Barry, and some things perhaps I ought to correct. Or inform you of, and Barry, there's a bicentennial meeting here, I think it's Wednesday, April the 23rd. You can put in your plug for whatever you might like in that store. But ladies and gentlemen, while I have prepared many notes for tonight's meeting, and I was given plenty of advance notice of this from Mr. Arthur Walker. Bear in mind that I'm about the fifth speaker, and you know, after the fifth speaker, you know, people start to get bored or tired, and if I see somebody going to sleep, I'll knock off straight away. But Mr. Bryan, so I think that there's one thing I'd like to insert in your speech, and that is the contribution made by one Councillor Hubbard. I can assure you, around the council table, that if there's anything that comes up about the old homestead or the historical society, Councillor Hubbard makes sure he gets his plug in. And I was a bit amazed tonight when I heard from Mr. Walker that the Labor Party had lost their roof down there. I wasn't sure of that. I'm going to blame Councillor Hubbard for it. But seriously, thank you, Arthur, for the invitation to speak to you tonight on the 25th anniversary dinner and your sesquicentennial at Altona. I didn't realise that Altona had been going 150 years, but when Barry made the comment tonight about the explosive reserves being going for 90 years, and I must remember it, well, you know, there's a fair bit of licence about it all. And as I speak, I have prepared lots of notes. I know that I'll be subject to barrages of questions. They are as I remember it, as I see it. The dates are as I remember it. And when I look around the hall and I see the Chicanships and the Flemings and the Burts and the Nashes and the Hooks and the Trumans and the Petersons, the Grants and the Matthews, you know I'm in for some trouble later on. But I do speak with a lot of candour, and yet with the greatest respect for our forebears. And in doing this, I must say that, well, I'm only the tender age of coming up 63, and, you know, one's memory shifts around a little bit. But I think that probably what I'm mainly speaking about is the 30s, perhaps the 40s and the 50s, and everybody catches up here with the 60s and the 70s. I've been advised by Mr. Vic Matthews, only tonight as I sat at the table here, by my younger brother, that he virtually severed his links with the explosives department, must have been as of today, and the Grant family has recorded something like about 107 years of service with the explosives department, and that's not bad in an area that...
he's still alive!
But to give you some of the background of the Grant family, and I don't know whether some of you would remember my Auntie Mary. She was almost as old as my father, but she came to Altona in the year 1905 and visited the magazine to visit people that were known to the family then, the name of McKinnons and Stones. And I think if people like to search back, they were they predeceased and were went before my grandfather as officer in charge at the Exposure Reserve area. In about 1907, they came to Laverton, to Kiora Street, and they lived in houses there that were shifted to Altona. And the houses are still in Altona at about the corner of Sieve Street and Blythe Street, and I thought that may be of some interest to the meeting. At that time, there was no train to Altona, and when the grandparents and my uncles and father, they shifted to the magazine, they used to have to walk from the magazine to Laverton Station. Laverton Station wasn't located where it is at the moment, it was further east, and if I can sort of give you a mental picture, it was down around about where the highway, Princess Highway overpass goes over the railway line at the moment. But I'm here to speak about, not about the Grant family, but about Altona. And as I record, and in retrospect, Altona had nothing or very little. It was, where I live, of course, was the Explosive Reserve area, the early life. Lived next door to my grandparents, and a young family of uncles. And I can clearly remember some of the things of the late 20s. And that was when my younger uncles played football with the local football team in the Werribee Football League. And I think that our prem was either in 1929 or 1930 or 1931. I can remember Jakantia's shop in Railway Street North. And I can remember old Polly Train. So I have got a memory for some of these things. But at that time, Altona had no industry. Sure, it had an explosive reserve where explosives were imported from either the United Kingdom or South Africa. There was also the Commonwealth, or what was known as the BP oil refinery, located off Coroid Creek Road. And some of the residents, and a lot of the residents, at Arthur Nash and the Flemings, they worked at the Victorian Railways workshop at Newport. And of course, there were some RAAF personnel living in the area. And this was the days of the Depression, sustenance work, and minor road building around the area. And I'm sure that lots of the people around the tables tonight would remember some of the roadworks going on and some of the sustenance work. And I can recall the Esplanade being first constructed, and that must have been about the year 35, 36 or 36, 37. Principally, it was rocks put down and covered over with some sand and clay and put a little bit of bitumen over it, and that's served as a roadway for around the Esplanade. And when I talk of Altona tonight, I would like you to get in your mind, I'm speaking of that area of Altona which is this side of Civic Parade, beach side of Civic Parade, in other words, on the other side of the street, and only in the beach area between what you know as Sea Home and up to, say, the Explosive Reserve area. And that's about what Altona was known as, Altona and Sea Home. There were a few rough roads. Maidstone Street, at that time, was already a rough formed road up to Coroid Creek Road. Blythe Street was rough formed, and when I say rough formed, it was rough formed. It was just a track with sort of boulders built into it, and it was rough formed from Rose Street to Maidstone Street. It was sealed as a one-car track from Rose Street to Pier Street, and then it cut out. Pier Street was made, and if you went out of the town, you went round Queen Street. Queen Street was sealed, if I can remember correctly, from McBain Street through to about Beach Street. And at that time, Miller's Road, as it was known, was Victoria Street between the beach and what was Nellie Street, or Civic Parade, and was Cherry Avenue from then Civic Parade or Nellie Street up to Coroid Creek Road. There was no such thing as Miller's Road. Miller's Road was sealed in about the year 1937. Queen Street, as I've indicated, was a one-car track from Beach Street to McBain Street, and it was rough formed to where Fiddler's Farm existed. Anybody remember Fiddler's Farm? Or Fiddler's Farm? No, it was a dairy farm, actually, Vic. And it was, some would remember where Len Lane removed the garbage.
Macquarie's.
Macquarie, just east of Macquarie. Nellie Street was also, Nellie Street was rough formed, the rough formed track, this out here is just a rough formed track from Sea Home Crossing up to Romawi Street. There were potholes and it was a real snake valley. Get out, Vicky. I'll get you up and give us sleep. The mine houses were being built about that time, and these were built by Wren and Bell. If my memory serves me correctly, Mr. Wren was the influence of John Wren, and Bell was associated with the Tramways Board. I can remember the old Mullock Heap, the sheds, and the new mine location, but I can't remember the new mine working. And bear in mind, at this time, Altona or what there was at Altona was just open paddocks, plenty of boxthorn, a few pine trees down Davy Street, the street just a couple up here, went straight down to the beach, Rose Street, and along the beach from Rose Street, down past where Councillor Hubble lives. The open paddocks, except for the vine paddock houses, I've already indicated, were being built. There was nothing much after Rose Street. It was Dixon's and later Harry Kim's poultry farm, located in what was known as Lily Street, and later Greed Parade. I can remember the proposed sports park where the new mine was located, the now Slough Estate, and then only a bike track was established there. Did you ever ride around there, Arthur? Bike track up that way? I can remember Preswell's house being built in the mid-30s. That was in what was known as Fanny Street, now Rainer Street. Fanny Street, yep.
Yeah.
Now Rainer Street. Harrington's house around in Queen Street being built. Also Charlie Barnes' house being built around the CD Crescent. This was a building boom, I think there was about one house a year getting built. Bear in mind that on the south side of the railway line was pretty much the sand belt, and anything north of the line, there were no such things as drains. Anything that rained, well, the water just laid around until it evaporated. We had Cherry's paddocks around here, Rowden's farm on the other side of Coroid Creek Road. There were poultry farms up Miller's Road, and for the Historical Society's information, Stratton Pierce, who lives down just a couple of doors past Councillor Alan Shaw, he may be able to give you information. Stratton Pierce people used to have a poultry farm up Miller's Road about where Miller's Inn is now located. I think that you can all remember the stone crusher and the quarry where Altona Gate is now located, but there was no sealed road north of Coroid Creek Road until the summer of, I'd say it was either 37 or perhaps 36, and my memory doesn't serve me too well in that school, but I can well remember my father taking me to see Bradman, Donald Bradman, bat in the summer, and I'm not sure whether it was 36 or 37, and we drove up Miller's Road just after it had been sealed. On that occasion, and for the respect of our English people, Bradman made 270 on that occasion. Cherry's farm was located at the north end of Maidstone Street. Greve Dairy Farm was north of the CLR refinery. And I think that some of you would perhaps remember at the opening of the original hospital site here some years ago, Dr. Joel made reference to being paid in kind. People were so short of money at that time, and he was paid often with fish or whatever people might have had. And Mr. Jerry O'Connor, who was a pharmacist at about that time, told my father he did not even make his train fare on Sundays, and such were the times that the people lived through. The schooling, Altona had only something like 300 students with a sea home annex at what was then Marion's Hall. There's some of Marion family here at the moment, where grade 1 and 2 were taught, and at grade 3 the pupils went to Altona. St Mary's Roman Catholic School was in Fanny Street, up near Rainer Street, at the site of where the church was located. I think it was fair to say Altona was always last in school sports. There were no scholarships. The kids were often without shoes at school, I regret to say. Later, the government introduced free milk for those children that needed it. However, I think it's fair to say that people were proud for those that were in these tough times. They fished, or they rabbited, or they mushroomed in the surrounding paddocks, and they picked up a day's work. And you might not be aware, but the family were often involved. In fact, the telephone would frequently ring, and the people would see a ship out in the bay, and this was when explosives were being imported into the country at that time, and people would ring my father up in order to try and get a day's work. Not a week's work, but just a day's work. It were certainly tough times. I think I get a bit negative at this point and I say Altona had electricity and water to certain areas. It wasn't to the magazine. In fact, electricity didn't go there until after 1949. But it had no gas, no sewerage, and in the earlier part, no hospital, no doctors, no roads, no footpaths except Pier Street, south of the railway line, no stone wall along the beach. Altona had plenty of sand, seaweed, boxthorn hedges, substandard dwellings, fishing villages. Am I right?
Yes.
Snakes, sharks, land sharks. There were tram cars located in Cumming Smith's property, which is now Logan Reserve. There was the horse trough under the big tree in the Coles Corner. The old bluestone buildings where the library is now situated. Marsh's Butcher's Shop, Duren's Grocer's Shop, Gil Martin's, where Tom Ward's shop now located. Lawler's Shop, Archie Laird's, Delahunty's, Parham's Corner, Davies, the Lifesavers, some two confectionery shops along the Esplanade, the RSL Hall at the south end of Bench Street.
Yeah,
remember?
Right.
You remember Lawton's Corner? Lawton's Corner? Lawton's, the Commonwealth Bank site. And oddly enough, there were lots of business, you know. There were grocers, there was Chorley's, there was Sam Tapman's, there was Parham's, your ends, fairs, bunkers, grooms, greenies, and even lad used to come from Newport. At that time there were dairies. I think there was something like 11. There was the Uncle Angus was involved in one. There was greens, hodges, grooms, fiddlers, fiddlers, and I think anybody that had a cow ran a dairy and sold milk. But there was, as you well remember, the polio epidemic about 1937-38, and when so many children were affected by polio or infantile paralysis, and from that time the government introduced lots of restrictions on people selling milk, and there were certainly changes in the standard of health at that time. I mentioned Chorley's, and I could be corrected on this, but the advice that I did know was that Chorley's was a licensed grocery, and they had a special license to sell beer. Councillor Huddle may be interested in this, and it was what was known as a 2-gallon license. And in other words, they were only entitled to sell 1 dozen bottles of beer. And this presented problems, of course, during the war period when people didn't want to buy a dozen, only wanted to buy a couple of bottles of beer. But I understand there were only 2 licences of that type in Victoria, and one was here, the other one was somewhere down Apollo Bay Way, and it was something for the timber workers in that area. There were 2 butchers, marshes, gardeners, plenty of bakers, William Laird, Archie Laird. Elsom's used to also deliver it from Williamstown. Just up Pier Street here was an old shop about the site where Merrick Timber and Hardware are located at the moment. Nichols, Ida Nichols, you know Ida Nichols? Nichols' shop, Pier Street, was a produce and grain store. Woodyards, I'm not too clear on this one, but I've got Merritt's, Finley's, and Finley's is not right, there's an old chap in Finley's, I can't think of his name.
He used to be Lawless there too.
Lawless, is that right? Right.
Lawler.
Right. Bassey's.
Duffy,
that's the name I'm trying to think of. Duffy. And Otter's. The name Otter springs a name to me. I can't think that it was associated with Woodyard or something of that nature, but they lived around about Queen Street.
Billy Otter had a
grocery shop. Billy Otter, right, okay. The estate agents, Mrs. Darley Kigrey, Mrs. Lawrence, Bonds, McMurtry. Anyone like to go to sleep? Another 4 pages to go, yeah? The shoe repairers, Fred Beaton, McMurtry, hairdressers, Lester Reynolds, Percy Burke, and the petrol resellers, Chorley's, and later Davidson's Carriers, where the garage on the corner of Sargent Street and Blythe Street. I think I've about run out of people in commerce in the town, but in 1934, there was the centenary of Melbourne, and at that time, Mrs. Lawrence was able to get on the side of the government and Lawrence's centenary camp was located on the esplanade down near Maidstone Street. There was a confectionery shop later built on that corner. Also in 1934, about the November-December, there was a terrible storm in this area, and some of the sustenance work was done on the repair of fences around the exposure reserve. 33-34 saw also the beginning of an era around about this area, and there was some building of factories in the Deer Park area. This was the beginning of the production of explosives and leather cloth industry and sporting ammunition in the Deer Park area. And in order to give the hockey club a plug, about 1934, the hockey club was formed. I think about 1937 also saw the commencement of aircraft manufacture at the government aircraft factory over at Fisherman's Bend. But commercial explosives were starting to be produced in the mid-30s over at Deer Park, and at that time these were starting to be transported back from Deer Park to Altona. This was for the purpose of the gold and coal mining industry, and for that purpose a special underpass had to be constructed under the Geelong Road and also under the Geelong Railway Line. The underpass under the Geelong Road was filled in when the highway was widened there some years ago, but the underpass is still under the Geelong Railway Line. That was put in particularly as a safety measure for the purpose of transporting explosives over to Altona. To get back to perhaps some of the interest of some of the girls at the meeting, in 1935 I left Altona Primary School and went to Williamstown High School with Brian Tyrrell. There were two of us. We used to ride a bike. There were about 8 or 10 went to the Footscray Tech at that time, and I think, if my memory serves me correctly, a railway ticket for somebody under 14 that time cost sixpence. If you're over 14, it cost a shilling. But we rode our bike most times, and I'm not sure whether it was the July 36 or the July 37. There were 17 fogs in 1 month. I thought we were going to work in the night time. I think in the 1937, some of the girls in the gathering went to Williamstown High School. About that time, I also indicated that Miller's Road was being constructed, and it was the era of Bradman, and it was about that time that the new the hospital foundation stone was being laid. About 1937, that was in the new hospital. About 1938, there was attempt made for the construction of the straw houses. You know what the straw houses are? Mm-hmm. Straw houses up Maidstone Street. These were connite laid on straw and wire netting. I think that, if my memory serves me correctly, this was some sort of a connection with Walcott Forbes. Walcott Forbes was, I don't wish to be slandered or libel or anything, but Walcott Forbes was a man of some notoriety in the Sydney area. In the 1939, the Uncle John won a seat on the Werribee Council, and I think that about that time, Altona had a population of approximately about 3,000. And I think the voting at that time was something like about 700 to 400. And of course, in 1939, saw the outbreak of the war, and perhaps ironically, jobs became a bit more plentiful, but everybody was subject to some sort of manpower control. And I think it's fair to say, during the war period, that everybody in Altona took an interest in everybody else, particularly those that are away, and any news of any casualties or anybody wounded in action, the news spread very quickly. I think that you'd have to realise at that time that the post office was on the corner of Blythe Street and Pier Street, and of course telegrams went out from there, and it was the local exchange. And at that time Altona had a rather limited telephone exchange, and I can well recall some friends of the family that the telephone exchange was only up between 9 and 10 a.m. on Sunday morning, and some people rang these people and they were told, you can't get on to them, there's no use in me putting you through, I'll just see them go out. That was the state state of the play. They had to go round the corner of Blythe Street, into Pier Street, round Queen Street. They had to pass the post office. The person on the telephone exchange could tell a rumour to everybody coming in and out of the post. It was after the war that homes started to be built, and blocks of land started to become expensive. You could have to pay £100 for a block of land up off Lily Street, Lily Street, Blythe Street. This is where the Bren gun carriers were tried out in the sand holes during the war. There were plenty of bracken fern and tussocks and shell grit in that area, and I think that a prime site in Seaham at that time would have cost about £400. Perhaps I ought to get off and get on to perhaps some of the sporting clubs. During the war, the cricket club, years ago, the cricket club used to play just here, up near where Stan Eagland is at the moment, just off Pier Street. And, there were two clubs actually become established here about 1937. The Altona A&A formed a club as well. And we used to play up in Maidstone Street. Well, of course, during the war, with people being called up and going for services and that sort of thing, there was only one cricket club, and we played up in the paddock, just off Nellie Street or Civic Parade, just north of the Altona Primary School. And playing cricket in those days was just a matter of scraping the grass off, and you had your cricket pitch, you put your batting over the bare ground, and that was your pitch, and that's where you played. But they played an open paddock there, then later on went down to a site down where the Seaham School is located, and then after representations to the then councillors, we had land allocated almost on this spot, straight up Pier Street and just out here. But later on a council was established here and they took the site over. The hockey club over a period of years played in various locations also. Similarly up in Nellie Street on the north side of the road in Rowden's Paddock. Remember that one?
Yeah, okay.
And almost then went variously up south side of Nellie Street up past Waratah Street near the Seaham Station, and then to the Williamstown Racecourse car park on the site where the migrant hostel is now located, and then to the Pine Scout Camp where the hockey club was looked after very, very well by the chap that used to look after Williamstown Racing Club, Mr. Condon. And then later on in the late 40s, the hockey club came down here to where the youth club is at the moment. In fact, we had an old shed there. People don't realise, some months ago I spoke at the local hockey club presentations, and they have magnificent rooms there, of course provided by the council. And they couldn't believe, I mean there were virtually hundreds in the room this particular night. They couldn't believe that it was only about 40 years before that we used to get changed in a tin shed on a sand floor, you know, no showers, you just got changed. The times have really changed. The football club at that time used to play up Maidstone Street, and they used to play in the low section of the land there. It's around about where Lynette Street is. And if it rained, it flooded. So all they did was just shift the goalposts up a little bit, you know, and buy land in Red Street. But that's what went in those days.
Enterprise.
It was an enterprise, yes, and people had to get in and they had to make their own football ground or whatever it was, and had to mark their own hockey ground and what have you. Perhaps I ought to leave the sport and go on to an industry. And as I indicated earlier, Altona had virtually nothing. Of course, not too much happened during the war apart from winning the war effort. And it wasn't until the late 40s, about 1946 or 47, that Noble or Vacuum Oil had talks with Uncle John and other councillors from what was then the Altona riding of the Shire of Werribee. And in due course, the refinery became established on its present site. Later to become known as Standard Vacuum, or later the petroleum refineries in Australia. Few people might not know also, but at that time there was also a discussion of a Shell oil refinery becoming established almost on this site. Shell were actually interested in becoming established in Altona, but I think that it was probably the lack of personnel that sent them down to Geelong, and that's what I understood was the case. And I want to get a bit of a needle in here for those from Williamstown. It's about the late 1950s or early 1950s, Williamstown Council, when the refinery was only just become established, tried to annex that area of Altona. In 1953-54, we saw the expansion of the refinery where the catalytic cracker was built, and there was further expansions over the years of the 1950s with the alkylation unit, reforming unit, and the sulfur recovery units. And about 1957, Altona became established as a council in its own right. I think it's also fair to get a plug in at this point in time. And I think Werribee were glad to get rid of Altona at that point in time. The late 50s, early 60s, there was the announcement of the expansion or the petrochemical industry becoming established, and what I knew at that time was going to be a steam cracker, and that's all the petrochemical industry is. And 1961-62 saw the commencement of the petrochemical industry manufacture in Altona, with the all the ramifications, all the multinational industries that are associated with it, and all the good things that they've brought to this community. I don't think it needs to be pointed out to you that the October 1970 was the Westgate Bridge disaster. I'd been there for the first time about 1 month, and I was attending a meeting at South Melbourne Town Hall, and I got in the mayoral car that day and was driving back to work about midday. Heard on the radio about the Westgate Bridge disaster. What a disaster that was. Early 1972, I think it was, the Nippon Denso became established in the municipality, and in 1977, Toyota Manufacturing became established. And here to get another needle in, Williamstown Council again in 1979 again attempted to annex the north of Coroid Creek, including PRA, to the municipality, and was again defeated. 85-86, well, I think we're under some threat from the Werribee Council and Williamstown Council. They want to divide Altona. I can assure you that will be fought hammer and nails.
Yeah.
Yeah. What I've tried to perhaps indicate throughout my talk, and we put it in a few words, it was a bugger of a talk to prepare. It's a whole series of disjointed things, and I couldn't prepare it as a real speech. But what I wanted to convey was Altona, many years ago, had no industry. And now it is a very viable place, very viable community. In fact, I'll go so far as to say it's not only the best in the West, it's the best in Victoria. Yeah. 1986-87, well, who knows, jobs are disappearing. We've got 38-hour weeks, we've got 35-hour weeks, we've got technological advances, computers, etc. And the council paid a visit to one of the industries only a week or 10 days ago. That company announced that it is going to spend $15 million on updating their facilities. So I think that while we've got lots of things to look forward to, we've also got a few swords hanging over our head. And while I can say I'm proud of the achievement in Altona, I can look back many years and get a lot of satisfaction from what's happened, what's been done by our forebears, what is still being done. There there are some aspects of the community that I still like to improve. And to our visitors tonight, I made a comment earlier that the beach west of McMain Street, I like that tidied up. The educational facilities, I think that they still need improvement. The arts facilities, musical facilities, in other words, cultural aspects, the transport, and youth training and discipline. They are things that I'd still like to see improved. And having said all that, I still have left out lots of things that ought to be said. And I've made reference to Wren and Bell houses, Walcott Forbes connection with regards to the straw houses. But I haven't mentioned many of the old characters of the town. The Ned O'Briens, the SB bookmaker, the George Skinners. Nor the Patton family disasters, where five members of one family went out fishing and didn't come home. And then not long after that, one of them was shot in a duck shooting expedition over the back of the exposure reserve area. The house has been burnt down. Turner's house, and the one up the mine paddock, I've forgotten who lived up there. The fire brigade being formed. The life-saving club and its sterling work. The Dick Blomberg, the socialist. I can well remember a local state election where the three participants were Jackson, Lemon and Payne. And the saying was, Mr. Jackson ate a lemon and got a Payne. Mr. Lemon was the excellent sitting member. And Mr. Casey, Mr. R.G. Casey, the Honourable R.G. Casey, having the seat of Corio. There were some ships that used to come into the pier, used to ship explosives out of the town, out of the bay, the Hooya, the Piri, the Alma Dopal, some of the port ships, and I think that for those people that are interested, some of the streets in the new part of the municipality over the west are named after those particular ships. I think that I ought to close on saying Altona was a nothing town to now a viable municipality. No jobs to an area where people are quite affluent. The industry has made Altona. I make no apology for that. But I do think that we are starting to become over-regulated, over-governed. And perhaps the best hope for Altona is that we in due course become a marginal seat both state and the Australian governments. I also hope that Altona will be retained as a municipality in its own right. I thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Grant. I'd now like to call upon questions. I'm sure there's plenty of people here that have questions of Councillor Grant. Who would like to be the first?
Yes. Oh. Rush used to have a shop round in McBain Street. He was associated.
That stupid old place is still there. You know, there's still a little shop there. What I was about to ask him was about, can you remember the old original fire brigade?
Yes.
Station? Now that place is up for sale. It's the rather. Now we'd hate to see this thing disappear, just knocked down and something put up. So I just wonder whether you'd be interested in having a look at that, because we live next door to it, so good with all the muck and stuff that's growing around. I hate to have to clean up the match or anything like that. So I was just wondering whether you could have a look at that and see whether the fire brigade, I was going to ring the fire brigade and ask them, would they be interested in retaining that little area? You know that area yourself, don't you?
Yeah, sure.
And old Mr. Rush, can you remember the old library was there? He's still got his old books, you know. He used to let them out for threepence. Mrs. Rush used to let them out for threepence. And still marked on the books threepence and all this kind of thing. And Agatha Christie and all those beautiful old books, they were terrific. And we've tried to retain that theme because we feel, well, we just came in from nowhere, you know. So we'd have a place for sixpence, so we bought it. It was terrific. And we've tried to retain, as you can appreciate, and that part is an original part of Altona. It was not, you, I mean, don't get me wrong, but you're talking the 1930s, 70s and that, you know, we were big kids then. But this is going back to 1920 that place was built. We went into it, we couldn't understand why our two different floors. Apparently one of the floors must have sunk, so they made it a, you know, split level landing. But, it's a terrific little place there, and we'd hate to see it disappear. And with the, but coming up with this fire brigade, we don't know what can happen there. So I spoke to Arthur, and I just wonder, is there some way of retaining that little area there? They may like to develop it. That is something very important. That was the original fire brigade station in Altona, and it must be something. And we feel that we're involved with people like yourself. And
to answer your Colin, if I can just make
certainly.
A few brief comments. The homestead has taken a real battle to get registered on the Historical Society.
Oh, good.
The old post office on the corner of Bly Street, Pear Street, they didn't consider that worthwhile retaining.
No, it's
great. Now, you know, I would say, to be fair to you, that they wouldn't even look at it. I mean, I've had a photograph for the purpose of the history of Altona by the council. I couldn't tell you where the photos are, don't test me on that one, but I'd say you can park
them. I see, because we wouldn't have seen the old Hollywood side ones,
yeah.
And up there in the section there.
She said, we all have our little tussies, she said, but nothing ever happens, she said. But anyhow, getting back to Davies Cafe, that's when we used to come down, we used to walk from Newport down to Davies Cafe, and we were steps in the 19s, 18s and 19s, and the 22s and the 23s. In 1908, in my memory, I walked about 4 or 5 walks from Newport to Altona, and an aeroplane landed in a biplane. We all went down to see it rise off the ground, but it was too windy, so it couldn't fly.
Yeah.
So just to prove to you, I've got some medals here. 1922, 1923, where we played football in front of the home station. And there's two young chaps here tonight. Where are they? Where are they? The Doug? Hey? Well, Doug, yeah, I was here, look at him, Doug in Bly Street. Their father was the president of the club at the year that I won those trophies. That was Graham, what was his name? I'll get his little
name. We have one further question, please.
Yes, Mrs.
Hill. Yes, Mrs.
Hill.
Did it ever snow in Altona?
Yes, it has snowed in Altona. I think it snowed twice in Altona.
Yes, August 9th. You had plenty of horses.
Oh, we went to New
York.
Well, you may be interested to know, in the early 40s, during the war, the Altona Primary School and the Mothers Club, the secretary, a sort of a fete. We made 80 pounds, and Mrs. Minnie Woodyard and I counted out pennies, halfpennies, threepences, And we got the sum wrong with me at first, but we finally got £80. That was a lot of money in those days. £40 had to go to Red Cross and £40 to the Altona Primary School. That was a big effort.
Councillor Grant, on behalf of the guests and the members of the society, I'd like to thank you most sincerely for your most interesting talk this evening. I think you're a very brave man to confront all these experts, long-standing. I was wondering whether you were going to get corrected, but your history must have been spot on, because everyone seemed to be in agreement with what you were saying. So it sounds like that you should have been writing the history of Altona, not this lady that's been appointed by the council. I'm sure by the attention that was given to you this evening that you could see by that everyone was most interested in your talk. But as I said before, we thank you most sincerely.
Altona Baptist Church Hockey Club, and supported the hockey club in the time that I played with it, and coached me and gave me good advice and tried to keep my ill humour in check when I got ill humoured. And Lawrence Fleming has obviously done a sterling work with the Historical Society, and Larry, I congratulate you and thank you for your work, not only with the Historical Society but within the community, and for what the Fleming family may have done in Altona in the past and for the future. Congratulations.
I was hoping that you would present this last, because I'd like to say a few words, if I may.
Well, you please yourself, you go if you like, lad. Arthur, would you please come forward? Well, if you stay there, I'll pass it across to you. Similarly, ladies and gentlemen, I mentioned I had some connection with a hockey club, and many years ago, as a lad of the tender age of 16, I went to see a game of hockey when they played over at the Pine Scout Camp, and this was just prior to the war starting. When I got over there, and they had a second team running, and they said, "Oh, you can play hockey. Go home and get your boots." So I had to ride my bike from the other side over the race course, over to the magazine, which is about 4 miles, then back. Be back here by, I think it was 3:30, and I was put in a team with Arthur, and there was an association with a hockey club that I treasured, and it was a terrific time. There were some good hockey players in that. In fact, the team played itself into the finals, and we were defeated in the grand final, and I can't understand yet what happened. Arthur, I think that Mr. Bryant's made reference to your sterling work over the period of time with the Historical Society, and they may live in Essendon at the moment, you'll be forgiven for that. May I, on behalf of the community thank you for the work that you are doing in the Historical Society and for what you're doing in bringing people into the community and for this sort of night tonight. I'm sure that some of my comments must have sparked up some memories in some people, and I'm sure and I hope the society will go from strength to strength.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, this presentation was to be to Myrna, Arthur's late wife, and to receive it on behalf of Myrna will be Arthur's sister, Mrs. Lily Mahaffey, who's naturally sister-in-law of Myrna, who is now in her 90th year and came to Altona first in 1906. In making this presentation, I think I told Arthur this, and I don't know whether you can record, but I told Myrna some time ago, when I first started school, and I made reference to box thorns, I fell on a box thorn, I got a box thorn in my thumb. And Myrna, who was one of the senior girls in the school at that time, tied my hand up with a handkerchief, and I can remember my mother washing the handkerchief and me returning to Myrna, and I never forgot that kindness. Congratulations.
Thank you.
This last one is to Mr. Alan Clark, a former president. Is that right? President of the secretary of the society, and Mr. Walker is going to receive it because the clerk, I think, is in the Northern Territory, is it?
New South Wales.
New South Wales.
I think that you might have been.
Yeah. He was in the Northern Territory.
As a matter of fact, to fill you in, Alan Clark, as secretary of the society, interviewed my parents. Well, back in the late 1960s, certainly prior to their death. And I'm sorry that what was said was not on tape, because they were both very clear on their history in Altona and would have been well worth hearing and remembering. And I don't know what Alan may have done with the notes, but Alan Clark, for the interest of most people, left Altona and went to Coburg to live. And with my association with MMBW, chap said to me one time, he said, do you know Blake named Alan Clark? I said, yes. He said, he's now a councillor at the city of Coburg. I said, oh, is he? And the association went on for some, about 12 or 18 months, and I said to this chap, then later on, a couple of years later, I said, how's Alan Clark going? He said, oh, he's up in Northern Territory, he's up in Darwin. You're nearly right here. please present on behalf of the society to Alan Clark. Thank you for the work that he's done over a period of time.
If I may be permitted to say a word or two, lately in going through information which the society has, and although I worked for many years alongside Alan, he was my secretary when I was president at the time, I'm amazed at the amount of research that he did, and he has given the society an invaluable amount of background, interest and work, and I'll be very pleased to convey your best wishes in giving this to him. Thank
you. Dean, we landed here a fortnight before World War was declared. My dad had to ride to work on his pushbike because there wasn't enough people in the town. We had a dairy at the time. There wasn't enough people in the town to buy our milk. We had to feed it to the pigs. And my mother was a Sunday school teacher before she was married. And she tried to get the Methodist minister in Williamstown interested in coming down to Altona to start a Sunday school. Now, there were only 11 houses. There was five that side of the Fair Street and five this side, except the homestead. And when the minister came down from Williamstown, it was in the Christmas time, and all the people came and stood on the beach in their bathing tops, and he was absolutely disgusted. He said he would never come near the place again if people couldn't get dressed to come to the service. The Lord knows what he would say if he went there and came down there and came there. Also, the Church of England, this is where you slipped out, Doug, badly.
I'll give a plug in, I'll give another speech later.
And he came down the following week, and exactly the same thing had happened, and he just packed up his goods. He said, I'll never come near this place again. He said, people are absolutely disgusting. So that's the way things started. George Lott, a minister of the, one of these fellows that helped the minister to
bring
the gospel, the late preacher. He was approached by my dad. He worked with my father as a blacksmith in the railway shops at Newport Station, known as the Seymour Branch. And he came down and visited all the families. Now, there were families over here at the racecourse, known as Headlands and the Robinsons. And there was the four Fleming families. There was four of us first, and then Francie and Chris came about 14 years later. The story to be told about that was my mother having a terrible accident. And she was advised when she was 55 to have another child. And of course, my mother was bedridden for 6 months. I was 12 years of age and I had to keep house. Not that that worried me. But George Loft started this Sunday school with four children, the Fleming family. And they met in our front room. And then the people started to come down around about 1916. Now, this Sunday school that my dad built, well, my mother was behind it, he said he would build a Sunday school in our backyard if the George Love said he would start the Sunday school. The Sunday school was built and opened in March. We started with four children. In September of the same year, the state school came into being. And the education department, the education department said that they would supply a teacher if a building could be procured. My dad said that you can have the Sunday school hall, and this is where our history book in the Historical Society is wrong. They say that the hall was built by my father for a state school. It wasn't. It was built for a Sunday school. So the teacher came down. Her name was Miss Bonington. She came down in September, and I've got the jubilee of the school at home with all the names of the teachers and everything. That book was given out, and I think I was the only one that kept it because I've never seen it. And I'm handing that over to the woman that is writing the history of Altona, because it's a very interesting very interesting stuff in there that she can use in the book of the history of Altona. Miss Bonington, Miss Brennan, and Miss Cuss. Now at that time, Billy Hughes' conscript army came into Altona. I have an argument with the secretary not the present secretary, the original secretary. Now, he said that the army came here and only stayed for 3 months. I say it stands, it was longer, and I'm going to get that confirmed from the army. They're the only people that keep the records. So that was teacher at breakfast in the morning, teacher at lunchtime, teacher in the evening, and she lived in our front room. We had to go and get her on the Friday, on the Monday morning, bring her down here, she stayed with us, and then Friday we had to take her back to Williamstown again because there was no trains. And trains didn't start to run until, when did the first train come down here? I remember it coming down into the Altona station, and we've got the photograph, I think Arthur would substantiate this, with a great notice on the front of it, Altona, on his chimney. So, and that the carriages were dollar boxes. Now, I was telling you about the Sunday school that was in our little hall, 30 feet by 11 foot 6, in the backyard, and it was there from 1915 until 1919. It grew from 4 scholars to just on 60. Now that will give you an idea of how the people came into Altona. And the school left our little hall, the state school left our little hall and went over to the Progress Hall, which is now the Baptist Church. Now that Baptist Church, Progress Hall, was built out of second-hand timber. It was built out of the stables that were behind Altona House, the coffee palace we used to call it in those days. And they built this with volunteer labour. All that's been done to that church was a new foundation put in underneath, and they put the boards around the side. Now the boards are so old that you had to actually paint them every 3 years to hold them together. They were all perforated. Now I think I'd better shut up, but so the early history that went on in Altona. I was waiting for our worthy mayor to tell you about the fire at the old COR. His brother came up and asked me, did I know anything about it? I said, I worked over there. I helped to build the tanks.
I said,
I'm on fire now. I'll tell you how the fire started, actually, because I was working in the tinsmith shop. We were all in the tinsmith shop. It was just across the fence, and the tank was over here. Now, the tank blew up. The top of it weighed 3 ton, and it went right up in the air. I didn't see it, but I've been told about it by Tom Murdoch, I think it was. It went right up in the air, came across, just came down by the fence, but it came across where we were, we'd all been killed. Now, that had 300 3/4-inch nuts. Anybody's interested in nuts and bolts, that'll give you an idea of the power behind it. All the boys rushed out. We were making kerosene tins. All the boys rushed out, and there's this great flame. Now, when it went up, it twisted. It was a benzene washer. It twisted about that much on the brick foundation. That was the nickel. Connection underneath, and there was petrol flowing everywhere. Now, they had big piles of sand in the area where these dangerous tanks were, and we weren't ordered to put the fire out until the firemen, of all people, put their hoses in the top and blew the flame right down the bottom, and boom, up she went. The whole yard was alight. I can tell you a funny story about Kendall.
Oh,
You're talking about Royce.
Logan, see the old CLO was built right on the Coy Creek. And as soon as it went up, Logan, it was about 6 foot something, made for the fence, and over he went over the fence. And the last thing we heard, the yarn got around that he dived into a haystack. It's funny the way yarn spread. But my mother and Mrs. Blair, I think it was, came racing across the paddock. Now, you know how far it is between here and the Iron Bridge where the railway line is. My mother came running across there, I don't think she ever stopped, and came in and wanted to know where her son was. And I was walking around with buckets of sand throwing them all over the place. She grabbed me and took me out. She said, "You're not going back into that place again." I had a good job. Anyway, I never got back there, but I had a lot of mates, and they finished up a boss in the end. I got a job in the railways as a labourer.
All concerned, a joyous occasion, a celebration of 25 years of the society, 150 years since Altona was proclaimed as a pastoral lease back in 1836, and of course our few very well-loved presentations to one or two of us, which we feel a great honour. But it has also got a tinge of sadness, because we have to say farewell to one of our best loved members tonight, Mr. Tony Seff. Tony, or as he originally was known down here, Mr. Anthony Chikansif, was of course only a young lad at the time, but was part of early Altona. With his sister's Faith, Hope and Charity. And we have one here tonight. Faith. That's right. Faith here tonight. Very bizarre.
And Anna.
And then also there was Anna. So that family was part of early Altona with the two-story second-hand shop and so on. Back in the days when there were no roads and when there was only car tracks everywhere. However, in the recent years, we have been greatly blessed by the fact that these folk have reappeared on our horizon. And as great and excellent workers, and Tony particularly, with no detriment to the ladies, were living out the other side of Melbourne, would come down regularly to our meetings and faithfully to our monthly work days on the Thursday, our working bees. And has put in a power of work. Now, circumstances have changed. He and his good lady have recently sold their house, have acquired a very nice caravan to go around Australia, and as far as we can tell, they aim to be away for quite a considerable time, and the great possibility is that when they do settle, it will not be in this area, possibly north up in the warmer areas of possibly New South Wales or Queensland. But Tony has particularly made a point and faith of being here tonight and being with the celebration. And so I'd like Tony to please come forward. The members have felt that you have been a wonderful asset to them, that we do wish you well as you go into your new life. As I say, there's a tinge of sadness in losing an old friend, but we know that you will still stay in contact with us, and that if ever you're in this area, there's nobody whom we would rather see than your happy and smiling face coming through the door. So with those few remarks, we'd like to accept the presentation pen with the best wishes of all the members of the Historical Society, and a card signed by all the members. All right. Thank you very much. All the best.
Notice this magnificent cake that is on the table. This cake was made by a master chef and icing cover or maker or whatever you call it. Decorator. Lavinia Hansen, and as I'm sure you'll agree with me, it's most excellent. It's even got the homestead on one side and the early aviator on the other side, I think. Is that correct, Lavinia? Oh, I've got something right there. And I'd ask the mayoress if she'd do us the honour of cutting the anniversary cake.
It's got a nice shame to touch it, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. Here's the...
Sunshine Historical Society, and as far as I know, she's the only representative from one of her sister societies.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you. always ready and willing to do a job along with all the others. He took the words out of my mouth regarding the excellent work that the ladies have done. The ladies and I have a very close association. We are a very, very happy band together, and I can assure you that the appeal that went out earlier for particularly those of the older generation, or shall I say those who knew the Altona of old, they are the folk whom we are asking to please come along and support us in this drive for the next year or two, coming up, culminating in the 1988. Mention was made of the bicentenary of Victoria in 1988, but of course, as far as we're concerned, it is the Altona centenary in 1988. In that year, of course, 100 years ago, the railway line was extended as a private line from the terminus, which was then at the Williamstown Racecourse, down to Altona. The pier was built so that steamers could come in and bring intending purchases of land down. Altona House was built as the station master's residence, and also as part of it to be a boarding house. Several